My colleagues that I worked with are Jennifer Chun, who works up in Seattle, at the university up there, and Albert Kim, who works at Middlebury College in Vermont. Okay, so, statistician there. Please do check out my GitHub. I also tweet out anytime I give slides or presentations. I started using this slide framework called Geringen by Zhu Wei. I really like them. These slides are available and they'll be able to link at the end, or at the bottom of each slide, bit.ly/pdx538. So feel free to documentation we have in our data package. Okay, so it's incredibly easy, I think, to be able to do this. And I'll also show you some background of what it looks like via our GitHub for the 538 R package as well, how we got the data in there, all that kind of stuff. So when I say creating the 538 R package, I want to show you as much as possible the steps that we took so that you can do similar things if you find code on the internet that you'd like to share with others. Okay? And then I'll have a call to action as well. Okay? So I think this is good for all potential users of R. We should all work together in some way, and I have an idea of how we can all work together. Okay, so that will come up shortly. Okay, so if you do have your computers, please do install these 5 packages. It was 4 on the meetup, but then I remembered that you needed RockStudio as well for documentation. And then the data set we're going to use today, I'm going to send you back to high school chemistry, and it's a data set, a data frame based on the periodic table. I don't know if that's interesting to anyone, I hope it's interesting to all of you. So this is a data set that we'll put together. We're going to build a periodic R package, P-E capital R, I-O-D-I-C. So that's just an idea I came up with a couple of days ago. Okay? Okay. So
let me just break in real quick.
Sure.
The Wi-Fi, the www.guest should be open, so you can just, if you need to install something or do whatever else.
Yeah, thanks, Scott. And please stop me. So I have a lot of experience teaching, so I will not feel comfortable if you are raising your hands and not falling asleep in front of me. Okay, so if something doesn't make sense, please stop me and let me know. So how this came about, the initial steps, was I was trying to teach students how to use R. And students that had never programmed ever before in their life. And I really just kind of got sick of seeing this. I mean, how many examples can you see with the Iris data set? Like, we get kind of what it looks like. It's really powerful for like k-means clustering, that sort of stuff. It's really nice, but who's just sick of seeing this thing?
So she says there's no pictures of Iris.
Yeah. I can't deal with this. So I was just thinking, okay, well, maybe there's another data set I can look at. Oh, geez. I mean, empty cars. Wow, this is a really relevant, interesting data set that, you know, students that were born in the 90s and potentially the 2000s are really going to be interested in the performance of 1974 cars. Okay, so I don't mean the dog on R, I love R, but boy, built-in data sets, they gotta do something about this. Okay, so this is my motivation. So I'm sick of seeing these things. I wanted really interesting data sets for my students to work with. So I thought, well, there's gotta be cool data sets that my students could use, and I'll just put them together into an R data package, and bam, this is gonna be easy. I don't know if any of you have experience trying to find interesting data on the internet. Boy, is that hard. Especially data that is clean. I don't want my students to, like, my students are already scared of programming. So I don't want them to be even more scared of programming by having to clean the data and deal with missing values. And, like, that is important after they get in there. I always focus on data visualization. I want students as fast as possible to be in ggplot, make some graphs, talk about the graphs. I think that's a great motivating thing, and I always say data visualization is the gateway to statistics or data science. So you get people interested in data viz, and they'll kind of take off from there. So I was searching on the internet, and oh yeah, these are links too, so I tried as much as possible to make these images links. I was searching on the internet, just trying to find data, and somehow I stumbled upon github.com/538. And I thought, oh my goodness, there is a data repository from 538. So I started looking through there. I found this data set, the police-locals.csv data set. So what this data set looks at is police force size, the percentage of police officers that live in the cities that they patrol over. That's all. And then there's white, non-white, black, Hispanic, and Asian, broken down in terms of the race of those officers and of whether or not they live in the cities that they reside in. Okay, so I was teaching a social statistics class, so I really wanted to find interesting, relevant data for my students from some sort of social background going on. So I was like, woo, yes, awesome. And then I remembered, okay, so we're gonna read in this CSV, and here's the repository where that file is stored. That's fine. This is what the raw data looks like, so we can read it in, and if we do that, we get a data frame that looks like this. Is okay, but what about this thing? Have you ever dealt with funky variable names in R, right? So in R, the hyphen means subtraction, right? So we can't have that in the name of a file, or the name of a variable, and so we have to put these back ticks around there, and so students have to deal with the back ticks, and have to deal with a variety of other things. And so at this point, I realized I'm gonna have to clean up the data, I'm gonna have to do all of these sorts of things. I just wanna do this. Load the 538 package. So this is like brainstorming. This actually does work now. But this is what I want students to be able to do. Load the 538 package, and then just look at police_locals, okay? And I wanted each one of these data sets to kind of be of the same sort of format. And so variable names, I didn't want them to be really, really long. I know our studio has a nice like tab complete, so you can have reasonably long data name, data object names, variable names. But let's try to make them as small and concise as possible. So there was police force size, but we're talking about police, so let's change this into force underscore size. Anytime you have things like spaces or hyphens, things like that, let's just convert those to underscores. Okay. Another thing I thought about was this data is actually not type, right? So that's a whole other thing that we're potentially working on, is showing the code in the little example when you load up this data set of how you can tidy the data and get it a nice format. Okay, so we want examples from a variety of different perspectives. We want nice tidy data sets for beginners to work with, and then we also want like a little bit more advanced users. So I decided I'm gonna do this. And then I remember, I don't know anyone at 538. So before I just go making a package of their data on GitHub, it probably would be good to reach out to someone. So Albert Kim and I were working on a textbook together, an open source textbook. I should have shamelessly plugged that right here. But I'll tell you, moderndive.com. So Albert and I were working on this free open source textbook together, and he had the exact same conundrum in his class. How do we get students working with interesting data sets? And so he said, I think I emailed somebody a long time ago at 538, and I'll just email them again. We'll cold email and see who we can chat with. And so we sent an email to this guy. Are you all familiar with Andy Flowers or heard of him? So, he came and gave a talk just a few months ago at Reed. That was all from just interactions that we had back and forth with Andrew. So we emailed Andrew Flowers and we said, hey, can we put this together into our package so more and more people could use the data in a really easy way? And so he said, yep, permission granted. That sounds awesome. And so we cranked it out. We got the whole thing put together. I'll show you how we did that. And then at our studio conf, in January, Andrew plugged our 538 package and showed the vignette that I had developed. That was awesome. Okay, that was like I have made it in the R community. Okay, so that was I got a plug on stage. So that was really cool. So yeah, it worked out. Okay, and it worked out really well. But there was about 80 data sets that Fire3D put together, and they have 80 different repositories. And so Albert and I realized, okay, that's 40 each. We will spend months and months and months trying to do this. And Albert said, well, wait a minute, I went to graduate school with someone named Jen. I bet she'd be interested in this too. So that's how we got our third collaborator, Jen Chun, to help us out with this. Okay. So how in the world did we do this? So what you can do is check out the data repository on 538. So I'm going to click on that and try to show you what that looks like. Okay, so this is what the 538 GitHub repository looks like. So they have a folder for each new data set that they want to work with. And then down here at the end, they have this awesome table that they put together with the actual headline of the article corresponding to what the actual folder is for that data. And they sort it from most recent posting. So it's really, really sick. So let's see, let's look at something that we've analyzed. So here's Tarantino. Ted knows where I'm going with this. But here's the Tarantino data set, if this works. Okay, so this is curse words and deaths in Quentin Tarantino films. And they have this really slick table that goes with almost every single one of their reviews. Okay, so our future plans for this, we haven't done this yet. Every time they post a new repository with a readme that looks like this, I want it to be pulled in to our package and automatically update the documentation. I have no idea how hard that would be, but boy, that would be cool, right? Just to have this perfectly synced up with, as soon as they post an article, maybe the next day, students have access, if they do, the GitHub repository of our package to be able to go in there. Okay.
Would that, doesn't have to go through like a manual winning process for every data set?
What's that?
Are you going through a manual winning process for every data set?
Currently, yes.
So if you had an automatic trigger, then?
It wouldn't necessarily be perfect, but they're getting better and better about getting their data sets in this kind of nicer sort of format. So it won't work in all circumstances, but if their data is of a reasonably nice format, hopefully we'll just kind of pull it. I dare even say that. I have no idea if this is a doable thing, but I hope it is, because I think it would be really powerful and awesome. So you can see that they all have the same sort of layout. Okay, so that's what the 538 data looks like. So what we do right now is once every 6 weeks or so, one of the three of us will go out to this repository and load in all of those folders to our data raw folder. So here's this is on Albert's GitHub, 538/data-raw. As much as possible, this is a direct duplication of what the folders look like on 538's data. Okay? Except there's some files down here. Okay, so I will talk about these files in just a little bit. So this is the actual code that each one of us did to clean the data sets and get them in a nice format. So you can look at any one of these things. Maybe I'll look at mine since I hopefully know it best. Okay, so this is on GitHub. We'll just look at the raw. Okay, so I one thing I really don't like doing is copying and pasting over and over and over again. I'm like, one, because I'm super error prone, and if I have to copy, I don't know, 30 times all of this stuff, it's gonna be a disaster. So usually, a little bit faster for me to just copy things, but I did a bunch of crazy, like, R code to make the headers nice here, so like, it goes through and does forecast methodology. And then I can enter the code right there. And it does hate crime. See, all of these have exactly the same sort of thing. I'm just notorious for doing that. Like, I will spend hours trying to automate something that would take me just a few minutes. Because the few minutes task, I'm sure to make an error there somewhere. So, I don't know if that's general best practices, but yeah, it's a way to, I don't even know if this code is good, but it works. So, that's something I try to do. So let's look at, you know, like here's the hate crimes data set. Okay, so remember, the data-raw folder that we copied over. And then in there is the hate-crimes folder. And inside that folder is the CSV file that we're requesting. Right? And then we start to do, this is one of the data sets that would not follow this nice auto cleaning sort of thing. So we've gone through and renamed this data set, or this variable, to be something shorter, right? A little bit more concise and easy to work with. So we do that for each one of the different kind of long variable names. And what does this thing do? Replace all spaces with underscore. And it's all column names lowercase as well, right? So this is applied every single data set. We make sure we just run this to get everything on a standard format. So students don't have to think like, is that a capital? Right? Case R is case sensitive, and students need to know that, but they don't need to get that error, over and over again. Yes?
Have you used clean names from the janitor package?
Yes, I just learned about this yesterday. I have not done that. Yes, but definitely need to do that because it will do a lot of that sort of stuff. Janitor clean names. Yeah. So this is another reason I love giving talks, because it's like somebody will say, hey, have you done this? And then it immediately makes my life way easier. So now every single time I'll use janitor and clean names. Yes, thank you. What about this function? What do you think this thing does?
Here's the hint.
It's a very subtle hint, right? What does that actually mean, right? So what this will do is, I have now, well, you can think about, I've run the code, and now hate crimes is the name of a data frame that is in my environment. What the use data function does is it takes that data frame, converts it into an actual R data frame in the right folder. Sorry, I shouldn't say R data frame, as an R data object. And then it's in the right folder, and everything's ready. Okay, so it takes something that is a very raw data set, like a CSV, an Excel file, something like that. You do whatever the cleaning you need to do on it, and then you're going to send that in as an R object. And then when somebody loads in this package, they don't have to go through all of the cleaning sort of steps, right? They don't have to do this to have access to the hate crimes data set. Beginning students have a nice, clean-ish data set to work.
Yes. Is it like saving it as an RD file?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yes.
It looks like when you access that object, the binding is locked, which prevents you from being able to manipulate it in the data. Is that by design, so that you can try and have some version control over the data frame?
The binding is locked on the RD file? Is that what you said?
So like when I call these locals and want to convert it to a data table, said you actually have to copy it before you can do it. I just was curious.
Oh. Yeah, it is lazy loaded. And I wonder if that lazy data loading is doing something funky, and that's why you can't do that. I mean, usually, so do data police underscore locals and force that load and then see if you can do data. I'm not for sure. I have done very little data tables, so I can't.
No, I'm just curious if like that was to try and preserve that version.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Does anyone know the answer to that question? I'm not sure.
I think there's a command to reverse what you've done to make it the data table back to, because you can manipulate it, and then there's I stumbled across one where there's a command to reverse everything back to make the data table go back to where it was. So like after you ran, you know, the code, then it would flip everything back. I lost
the cleaning. So if you just scroll through these, you'll see, you know, the cleaning is not terrible. They're pretty manageable data sets. I think that's nice. I think 538 has done a really good job of getting reasonably clean data sets out there. Another thing that they do for a lot of their data sets is they actually will show you the code that they use to get the data in that format too. Not all the time, I wish they did it more. But they'll show you kind of the raw data sets, and then what steps were needed to get it into this less raw form, and we'll do one more step to get it in a nice form for students.
Are they doing that in R?
It's kind of all over the place. Yeah, so just recently we saw a posting from someone that used Go to pull in the data sets and clean it. I had nothing from Go, so maybe that's a project to convert that over into R. But yeah, there's a mix of both R and Python. Sometimes they even have IPython Jupyter notebooks. So the editors and the writers kind of come from a variety of different backgrounds here. Nate Silver actually is a Stata guy. But they use a variety of different sort of programs. Okay, so I can't dog on Stata at a time, but it's expensive, so that's not my favorite. Let's see if there's... Yeah, so I mean, these are just, for the most part, these are interesting data sets for students to play with. And they're certainly relevant. So a lot of these data sets are from 2014 going forward. Okay. And not all of them are nice and clean. We did have to skip, not necessarily clean. Some of them are like, they have 80 different data sets that somehow need to be put together, and they did that in some way. So we've held off on that. Okay. And one thing all three of us, Jen, Albert, and I, are big on, and you'll see this in just a little bit, is we would love collaborators, and we would love other people to help us out with this in any way. And we'd love to add your name as a contributor to our package. Okay. The more helpful we can be in encouraging people to get their name out there, the better. Because networking is such a huge deal. It's awesome if you can say, I can collaborate and contribute to this package, especially if it's your first. This is the very first package I've ever had at Grant, the Firefighter 8 package. Okay? And lots of people have reached out and said, oh, that's so cool, that's awesome. Do you work with Firefighter 8? No, I don't work with Firefighter 8. Okay? So that's always, I always have to start all things with, I don't work for them. I only reached out to them and asked questions of them. Okay. So yeah, I encourage you to scan through these. Jen and Albert have very similar sorts of things. So we just decided we should have a very standard sort of way of cleaning up these data sets.
Okay. So then you have the document that says what those dimensions are, and you said a few things.
Exactly. So let's see. Yeah, actually, the next slide, there's a 538 package vignette here, okay. Which goes through a lot of the things. Talking about, you know, these are the guidelines that we try to follow. These are suggestions we have if you'd like to collaborate with us, those sorts of things. So we try to lay out what we're hoping for. And like these are the practices and the standards that we have followed so far.
So like when students turn their data to you, you kind of look to see if they follow these standards. You expect them to follow those standards?
So my students are working directly with these clean data sets. And so they don't even. Yeah, they're always using the standards, but it's because I forced that on top of them. Right? So they don't do crazy things like reading variables to something really long. They don't necessarily know better. That's another fair point. So the students that I teach are sociology and criminal justice majors. Okay, and I'll share with you in a little bit the group projects that these students have produced. I think they're incredible to be able to do in 6 weeks what they do. Okay? So I'll toot my own horn just a little bit. About what students are able to do. And actually, the assignment that I gave to the students was to write vignettes for this 5-year-old college. So I'll show you in just a little bit what some of the vignettes are that we've written. And then we reached out to him and said, hey, anybody, write some vignettes for our packages. And I'll show you a few of those that came in as well. So another thing that you have to do with our packages that not everybody does is document them. Right? So like, tell everybody what your functions do, and tell everybody what your data sets are about, and what the variables mean, and what the units are, all that kind of stuff. What's the observation unit for each one of these data frames? So we have a very standard practice going through, this is what the thing needs to look like, right? So here is this the title of the article, and then the raw data behind the story, this. With the link. So if you go to and search for the help for HIST Senate credits, you immediately have a link right there to go read the article. That was another huge thing that we want our students to be able to get better at is data journalism. Be able to talk about your data, do it in an interesting way, and so we want to provide them with lots of examples to do it just that. Okay. So this was something that I had to find. This is very tedious and annoying to try to make sure that you get each one of these things with each curly bracket, it's like writing in LaTeX, very similar to LaTeX if you've done that. So it's really easy to make a mistake on this. So with my stuff, there is a little script that I ran to try to automate these sorts of things. Pulling in from a Google Doc or Google Sheet of each one of the characters. So you can kind of see. So if you do a help on any one of these, you'll see candidate is a variable, the candidate reference is the name. Okay. And we're happy that if that's not necessarily clear or you need more information there, let us know. Okay? Or make a pull request and we'll be happy to grant it and say, yeah, that's way better documentation. Awesome, we'll keep track of you and give you credit this time. Okay. So yeah, I encourage you to just make a clone of our 538 repo, fork it, do whatever you want to do with it, play around with it, send us issues if something doesn't make sense or we did something in a terrible way. Okay, like the janitor comment, that's an excellent comment, right? So we're wasting lots of lines of doing that. I would push back and say, yes, but what if they don't know janitor packages and they know column names and then, but whatever, we should use janitor, it's way easier. Okay. So those are the two things. So one, you need to clean the data, get it in a nice format. Then use the use data function, export that as an RData object. And then document what are the actual column names in each one of those different data sets that you have converted to an R object. So that's really it. Okay? If you want to create an RData package, those are really the only steps that are required. Those are the two big main steps. Okay? There's a lot of little, like, getting the things set up, pushing some keyboard shortcuts to make these things merge together, all that kind of stuff. But really, that's it. Okay? So, if you have any sort of data that's interesting, this is not my package, but you all have probably seen this. Who has seen the data source thing? Nobody has seen this? Awesome. So, this is our data package that staff lock put together. Based on this. So this is an extension of Anscombe's quartet. These all have the very similar x mean, y mean, standard deviation of x, standard deviation of y, and correlation to two digits. So what's the story here?
Visualize your data.
Summary is not enough. Okay, so this comes from this paper right here, using this process called simulated annealing. So they essentially said, I want something that looks like this shape, and then they jittered the things to get it pretty close to that shape, right? So these things aren't perfect, except for the dinosaur. I think somebody told me that the arms of the dinosaur are actually not quite right. But, whatever. And so they just did this sort of process, and then StepLock said, I should turn this into an R data package. All that data is available, I should turn this into an R data package. And so she just loaded in that data, and boom, it's on cram. Okay, it took about a week for the data to be loaded in, and well, I don't know how long it took for the data to publish on cram, but it's already on cram. Okay, so data source with a capital R. This is an awesome, fun data set to really mess with your students or mess with your coworkers. Right? Say, oh, here's the summary information, tell me what that data looks like. it could be any one of these 12 options. Okay? So our data packages are really slick and really easy to make. Okay, so that's the first little push. I'm going to tell you, make an R data package of some sort. If you have some sort of interesting public data that you'd like to share with someone, if you're too scared to put it on cram, at least put it on GitHub and tell some of your friends where it is. Okay? That's my first call to action. Do that, okay? Okay, I'll come back to the big call to action just a little bit. So, another big thing that we wanted to push was writing really nice, concise package vignettes. And this is weird for us because this is a data package. So we decided our vignettes should be analysis on those different data sets. Or just talking about what are the general principles of our data. Heavy has this new package out called PackageDAO. I'm surprised you guys didn't write this, but this is actually Heavy. And it allows you to really easily create documentation on any one of your packages. Yeah, it's actually two lines of code, I think. Install package down and just run build page. And there it is, okay? So in here, there's a reference link.
This shows you all of the different data sets. It builds all of these for you, so you have to build any of your own different data sets. So let's see, let's look at like the Bechtel test data set. Okay. So it takes those different R data and documentation files and builds these really nice, easy to read data sets or documentation, right? So here's that link to that story about that. Okay, so check out package down if you have some sort of package. It works for functions and stuff like that too. It doesn't have to just be a data package. But yeah, it's super slick and easy. So I was going to show you under articles, this shows you all the different vignettes that are currently loaded into the 538 package on Crane. So right here is a 538 package vignette talking about the motivation that I talked about a little bit. That we wanted students to be able to minimize the prerequisites to research. So this is a famous article by George Cobb. Getting students working in this workflow as soon as possible, and not having them deal with all of the potential bad things you have to deal with messy data. Let's see, here's guidelines, naming conventions, no more than 20 characters, all lowercase, use underscores. So we try to keep it as open as possible. With variables, you know, turn things into a factor if there's some sort of natural ordering that's not just alphabetical ordering. For the data sets, that's much nicer for students. They don't have to reorder their plots. Things are in a more natural format. Date formats. So we say, we're just saying, if you want to contribute, you do all the hard work and then we'll say yes to your pull request. Okay? Because we've done this enough. It's not necessarily a fun sort of thing. But getting data in this nice format and the students don't have to deal with funky dates and things not plotting in the right order, that sort of thing. Right? So we encourage people to use Looper Data and make things nice. This has already kind of been updated via that other table I showed you, but this also just lists all of the different data sets, who were the actual authors of those data sets, and then there are some, we're going to make this an interactive table a little bit, so people can go in and search for, I want to look at all movies data sets, and then it will pop up, and people will be able to just analyze the different data sets that come with movies. Oh yeah, the news comes in as well, so you can see the things that we've done. Okay, so one of the data sets, I alluded to Bechtel, but one of the was this Bechtel analysis. And so I looked through this R code, I thought, okay, that's nice, but I want a tidy person plot. Okay, so make the code ggplot, make it dplyr. And so I went through the code and did just that. Okay, so one nice thing about these vignettes is it's just an R markup file. So there's nothing particularly fancy about this except at the very top of the R markup file you say it's a vignette instead of an HTML markup or something like that. Okay, so it just walks through filtering the data, determining these averages, determining the medians. And looking at some different distributions, this is the exact same analysis that they did, except using ggplot instead. Let's see. They fit a line, they looked at log instead, whether they passed or failed. What do I want to get to? Down here, yes. Okay, so you can start to see that it starts to get a little bit crazy. The code starts to get a little bit intense. Try to replicate exactly what they had done doing the tiny person. Oh, have you guys ever seen this on there? I can make this a little bit bigger. So this is percent less than greater than percent. Who knows what this does? So this does the assignment as well as the type. So this is the same thing as doing med groups, assignment operator, med groups, pipe, mutator. This is in the McGritter package, so it's not built into dplyr at all. The bad thing about this is I don't think anybody knows this. So you have to be careful. Maybe I should have explained exactly what that is, but it's kind of a nice trick. So there is this plot in the article that's referenced at the very top that looks at whether or not, so this looks at return on investment on movies that pass the Bechdel test or don't pass the Bechdel test. Who knows what the Bechdel test is? Who wants to explain what the Bechdel test is? Okay, Alex, I'll explain what the Bechdel test is. So this is a movie rating sort of thing. So either a movie either passes the Bechdel test or it doesn't pass the Bechdel test. In order to pass the Bechdel test, a movie must have at least two women characters, and those two women characters must talk to each other, or at least one other woman, about something other than men. That's it, okay? Passing the Bechdel test or not. And so you would think, I don't know, what percentage of movies pass that? 80%? 85%? No, okay? About 50%, if you look at the last 10 years of movies past this test. So there's a website, Bechdeltest.com. It's crowdsourced. You can go on there and say, I watched this movie. It falls into this category. And then somebody else will go on there and say, I confirm that answer. Okay. So part of the story analyzes and shows how that has changed over the years. 1970s movies, were they as bad or worse? They're actually worse. Okay. So we've actually gotten slowly better. But movies over time were not necessarily good at 70s movies in passing that. Okay. So I really wanted to be able to produce this graphic. I'm just going to show you. 538 Bechdel test. And they've written a couple articles about this. This is the first one, written strangely enough on April Fool's Day, 2014, but this is actual legit data. let's see if I can find. So this is that plot. That I always encourage my students to try to reproduce. And they can actually do it pretty easily using ggplot. Okay, so they were a little bit kind here and included dubious as a pass. So this means that someone went on there and said, yeah, it passes, and somebody else said, no, I'm sorry, not pass. And so they just said, put it down. Put it in there and pass. Okay, so not great. Right? So here's 50%. It's roughly right around there. Okay. The plot I was trying to reproduce is down here at the bottom. This thing. Okay. I asked Andrew Potters while he was here, you did this in ggplot, didn't you? And he says, yes. 538 has a custom ggplot theme that is not available to the public. Those jerks. But there are ways that you can get to pretty close. So this is what it looks like without any coloring. That's what it looks like with some. Okay, but it takes some work, right? It's not necessarily easy. Yeah, I even thought about that too. I should make a color picker and get all these things in there. But I looked at this code and I thought, I need to stop on this. Too much stuff. Okay. So those are a couple of vignettes that have been produced. There's two other vignettes that were published in the most recent one, analyzing NBA. Drafts, actually, by G.L.A. Morris, who's actually a political scientist that works for the Crosstab. So he writes a lot of blogs about political science, but he's also interested in the NBA. And so it's this analysis analyzing which NBA draft class was best. Okay. Adam Spanbauer, looking at Trump's Twitter from. This is 2016 Trump Twitter, so this has not been updated. Sentiment analysis on Trump tweets. There's five most positive tweets. Wow, Edgar Cole said I won the debate last night. Very long. Most negative tweets. Okay. So yeah, just fun. This was something I really got to kick out of. Sentiment by hour. Or by day, or by month. So just fun, like I would have never came up with this idea, but Adam did, and you know, on Twitter, he reached out to us and said, hey, I created this vignette, can you check it out? He said, yeah, I can pull request. Boom. That's our creator. Okay. So, my students.
I'm a little bit confused. The 538 package that you've written, are people submitting pull requests or arbitrary data against that? Or
no. Only the 538 data in our package.
Okay, I understand.
That comes from the 538 repo. Their data.
So this was a pull request for some story about how the Trump tweets.
So this was, yes, this was an analysis on the Trump tweets data that exists in the 538/data repository that thus exists in our 538 package. So this is just an analysis of the data sets that are available. The 80 or so data sets that are available in our 538 repository. Yeah, so they're not uploading their own data. This was actual data that 538 had published. Okay, and there's other vignettes on Crayon too. I'll leave that for you to explore. Okay. Another thing I did is I was trying to figure out what's a good group project for my students to work on. And I have this debate with myself all the time. Okay, do I just let them go find their own data and then they analyze that data because they'll for sure be interested in that? I've done that. Didn't sleep a lot those semesters. That's hard. Students really love that and it's awesome for them. It's a great experience, but it's a lot of work for me. Making sure that the data is clean, making sure it's up the right format, all that kind of stuff, because they don't necessarily have the tools to do that. So I just thought, why don't I just, I'm getting these package vignette requests coming in, and I think my students have the ability to do the same sort of thing. They want cool data sets, so they have 80 data sets to look through, they work in groups of three. I say, pick your top two, and I'll assign you to work with one of those data sets. And what some students did is they said, well, we learned how to do join. Can I join two data sets together and analyze that? And I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. So some people, you'll see, did the Bechdel test combined with Tarantino films. Trying to see, how does Tarantino do with solving this thing and make money, like swear words, all that kind of stuff, okay? So the R Markdown source code for all of these is on GitHub for each one of the different projects. So you can go pull that down and check out the analysis, do whatever you want to do. Okay, I'm going to look at the knitted HTML documents.
You're going to share my data?
Yeah.
Yes.
Ted even tweeted out about one of these just a little while ago. Okay, so police killings in the western U.S. in 2015. So they focused data that broke out the entire U.S. They said we're only interested in the western states. They analyzed that. What contributes to bad driving? Let's see. So they actually built some maps to show how they split up the regions. So they had to decide on who goes where. And so they did this, and amazingly, with a little bit of help from me, they were able to use GeoMap. We had not picked up that in class to make some nice stuff. Then they further split that down into division, which region has the most accidents. North Dakota, actually, has the most accidents per capita. Okay, now remember, these are sociology and criminal justice majors who have worked in R for 6 weeks. They made this. Okay, so anyone, I think anybody has the capability to do stuff. I advocate for using the tidyverse. Okay, don't teach students base R until later. Okay? You gotta hold their hands early on. And I think the tidyverse is a really nice, comfortable hand. Okay. So that's been my experience. Okay, so I can scroll through that, but I'm gonna go back. We'll go back to number four. Okay, so we actually, I hesitated in just always throwing this up there, but this actually is an analysis of this. Okay, the very last slide, the very last graph shows how that word appears in Tarantino movies. Okay? So my lesson from this is I need to make sure and look over all of the 538 data sets before I say you can pick any one. But I didn't care, right? Like, they're all mature, they're perfectly fine, and it's just super fun, right? And so they had a great time doing this. Yeah, so Kill Bill, actually. It's not very
frequent. As he's aged, he's...
Oh, I think... Yeah, I don't know if they did that analysis. Another group did that analysis to look at how things have changed over the years. Oh yeah, so here's a way to use case when. If you're ever looking for an example of how to use case when. There you go. We'll have to put an asterisk on YouTube for this one, Scott. So students are able to do that, okay? So, like I said, if you stumble upon one of these interesting data sets and you say, I'm able to write up, would you mind checking this over? We're happy to look it over, and we're happy to add you to the contributor package. Okay, so I haven't pushed all of these to CRAN yet. Semester just ended, but I'm hoping for you, my students, to be collaborators and contributors on our packages. Okay, I think that's an awesome sort of way to get their name out there. Even if they never do anything with R ever again, it might be a Google search. There's their name with some R package. It will lead to some interesting discussion. Okay, that's all I can really hope for. Yes?
What are they using to make those tables? Does it look like cable and whatnot? Is it?
I think it is cable. I'm trying to remember. Let's go look at the repository.
Could you repeat the questions?
Oh, sure. So are they using cable to make those nice tables? I believe they are, but I need to go check. Here, yes. So that is a cable. If you have it as HTML_vignette, that's what cable will produce as those nice kind of tables. So those are the same tables that you see on CRAN. Well, not all tables look like on CRAN, but if you do df print cable, then it will produce that same sort of table. Yeah. This is a super awesome feature as well. So then if you print out a data set, by default, we'll put it in that nice, cool cable format. So it won't be the kind of raw, ugly sort of data set. Okay. So one thing I realized pretty soon after we got all this thing all set up, Andrew Flowers actually does not work full-time for 538. He's actually an economist for Indeed. He actually took off a little bit of time, freelanced, was just a journalist, and now he's an economist for Indeed.com. Okay, so what that means was he was kind of the guy that we would go to when we had particular questions about data sets. He was the quantitative editor, and so he really encouraged the authors and the journalists to publish their data as much as possible. So what happened when he left is we kind of lost our guy. Okay, but every now and then journalists will republish the stuff. But it's not as common or not as frequent. Okay? And there are people that we try to contact, but unless you have institutional backing, I think this is a hard sort of thing to sell, right? It's one more thing that people have to do, share your code, share your data, okay? So that's kind of a hard thing to do. So we've reached out to a variety of different places to try to get them to do the same sort of thing. We have not had a relationship set up yet, okay? We're still working on that. So here's my call to action. Think about the newbies. Some of you are even newbies. Heck, I try to be a newbie as much as possible. Think about the newbies. Think about if you were back again, just learning R, I would guess you would like to have had interesting data sets. Right? I mean, maybe some of you are like, Iris is interesting. Okay, and maybe it is the first time you see it, but I think it kind of gets lost. So, what I'm thinking is, if we're looking for opportunities to work together in some way, we all have the capability to find interesting data sets, check their licenses, make sure it's actually okay to share them, and contribute together in an R package. Okay? So have nice, interesting data sets. Interesting can mean a lot of different things to you, right? And maybe that's the reason why these things don't exist. We need to find interesting, relevant, current, kind of easy to manage data sets for students and newbies to R. Okay?
You know what I was going to suggest? That I'd like to see business data. Like you could do inventory, like, you know, what sells fastest, what do you have in stock that will sell quickest, and then you have like real world stuff that you can explain and maybe sell to a business or something like that too. You had something where you know, The diamond set is close to that, like that kind of thing, where you can go, well, you know, this will show you that, you know, this is more valuable than this one is, and you know, if you can do that kind of stuff with your own business and show people, you know, the benefit to using data for that.
For sure. Yeah. Yeah, so reaching out to businesses in some
way. Something,
but yeah,
like
so businesses probably are going to say, I am not sharing my data, that competitor is going to steal all my information,
well,
I can't do that. Right?
Customers'
so
names, yeah.
That's
not,
yeah,
and
so you have to be careful with those sorts of things.
It's
right?
Going to be messy as hell, too. I mean, Oracle and SAP databases for businesses are just full of crap. At least the company in the industry I've been in.
For sure. Yeah, so this is a hard thing, right? So I am reaching out to all of you. I reach out to your friends. This is like the most barest bone of potential repositories I've ever put together. I was hoping to get a lot more stuff in here. But I think what we need is a raw data package. Okay? Just like there's a 538 package, let's have a raw data package. And one thing is, with our packages we're going to publish to CRAN, they can't be really massive data sets. Okay? So you might have something that's a 10 million rows by 100 columns. That's not exactly the type of thing I'm thinking about here. Some sort of interesting data set that might have 1,000 rows and 6 or 7 columns. Okay? So, extremely basic principles put forth in this are raw data package. Okay? Like I said, this is extremely raw. I just put this together a few days ago. But, you know, reach out to me if you have an interesting data set or you'd like to collaborate with me on this. Twitter, email, all those sorts of things. I would love to collaborate with you on trying to go through this. Somebody suggested you should check out this repository. Awesome public data sets. So maybe this is a good place to start. There's a huge table of contents and there are a ton of different data sets here. So if you want somewhere to start, potentially we should just go through these links, see where it leads us, document that somewhere and say, hey, this is an awesome example. Hey, don't go down that pigeonhole or rabbit hole, right? Don't do that, okay? So something like that. So I'm thinking maybe we could create a Google Sheet and just crowdsource it and we go through this stuff and add data sets and look at this. Okay. So just me brainstorming on some sort of project that we could all do together, okay? So, I'm not gonna like make this a sales pitch. Will you join me? But I'm asking you, okay, if you have some time over the summer, seriously think about this. And I think this would really transform the R community, really get some interesting cool data sets out there that people just might know about and might not know about. Okay, so think about doing that. Okay, so we have relatively little time, but that's okay. So I wanna just walk through the steps for building an R data package. And then if you have your computers, I'm happy to kind of watch you do this, follow these steps, support you. If you need to get going, that's cool too. Okay? Okay, so I printed this off. Does everybody have one of these now, I think? Okay, if you don't, I'll get one to you when you need to. But there is a link to the PDF right here as well. Okay? I think this is super useful. This is one great resource. Have these R packages book. You really should just read that book. It's available for free online. I usually just do a Google search. R packages, Hadley. Really lays out exactly every single step that you should take if you're trying to build a package. Yeah, it can just be a data package. I gave another talk here last August about creating R Markdown templates. And so you can just have the package be an R Markdown template that you'd like to share with others. Okay, so you don't have to go crazy and think that you have to like reinvent the tidyverse or something like that. Like you can start very bare bones creating an R package. Like every time I create a package that isn't even on CRAN, it's like, whoa, yeah, like achievement unlocked, right? Like every time you create a package that you potentially should want to share with somebody else, that's a big deal. And so I encourage you to do that. So please check out Hadley's book and check out this little cheat sheet as needed. Okay, so if you want, this is the same thing I had up at the very beginning, that link. So this is the CSV file, that's the periodic table, data. Okay, so I have not done any little analysis with this, but something I just kind of put together from a variety of different sources. Okay? So, I am not going to walk through these steps one by one, but I encourage you, when you have time, or right now after I get through walking through these, to follow these steps, and if something doesn't make sense or something doesn't work, create an issue on my GitHub page, and I'll update that for somebody else to go check out, okay? So, obviously you open RStudio. This is way easier if you're working in RStudio. Then you need to figure out where you want to put this project. So navigate to set your working directory to be wherever you want to do it. Then, on the front page here, near the middle, under the write code thing, it says DevTools Create. Create a template to develop into a package. So this copies over a lot of the files that will be needed, kind of the bare bones of what's needed to create an R package. And then you have to give it a name. So I gave it this name. Hurry up. And I think you need to do this step next. After you have created that project, open the R project file, and then we'll kind of load up. Because RStudio works on kind of projects at its base, and so if you open up a file that has the structure of an R package, you'll get some extra sort of features up at the top. Like you'll be able to build the package just via one button. You'll be able to do a lot of stuff like that. So it's important to work with R projects, RStudio projects. Then if you run this function, use underscore data underscore raw, this will create a data hyphen raw folder in your repository and also set up some settings behind the scenes. So it'll make sure that it doesn't build this file over and over again when you want to build your package. That folder, lots of kind of things like that. Okay, then you've downloaded that file. I want you to move the file that you have downloaded from my GitHub. Put that into that data raw. Okay, now I'm trying to mirror kind of the process of what we did with the 538 package here. So remember we had these process underscore data chest or process underscore data output. So you can follow and do whatever you want here. I kind of like just calling this process underscore data dot R. So this is a file that I put right there in the data raw. So this, if anybody wants to go look and see how I cleaned up the files, well, they're all right there, okay? Then I say write the code to read in this file as a data frame, and then give that data frame the name periodic underscore table, okay? And if you know anything about, if you remember from chemistry, there's this thing called the block that elements fall in. SPDF. Is that right? Okay, good. So, alphabetically, those are not in the right order. Right? DFPS. That's how it comes, right? So you need to convert that over to a factor. So this is essentially the cleaning step. Right? It's not a big, huge step, but you need to clean the data and get it in a nice format. After we have done that, just like we did with our files after we did the cleaning, you run this use data function in the DevTools package. And then if it was created before, I'm going to overwrite it with what incorrectly should be overwriting history. Okay. And then the last step, I actually created a sample R documentation thing for you to kind of play with and look at. So there's all these kind of, you see these listed on here, the different types, common R oxygen tags that you can add. And so this just shows you for each one of the different variables, discuss what it means. So you can do whatever you want creating your own, but here's a sample, something that works. Let's see, I do actually talk about how I collected this data. Web scraping and cleaning the wiki page for the periodic table, and also combining columns from code elements from, I didn't know this, but there actually is an R for Dummies book and then a corresponding R for Dummies R package. It's on the grant.
We do.
Okay. So combining those different things and scraping data from here. That's how I got data in that format.
This is a Roxygen?
Yes. That's right. This is a Roxygen formatted thing. So you can kind of see that. This is the hashtag with a little, what's that thing called, quote mark, right after it. Okay. Okay. So what you can do is just directly copy that data.r file. You don't have to call it data.r, you can call it whatever you want, into the R folder. So put those files actually into the R folder where your actual code is going to be. It's going to compile every time you do a build. And then there's this slick keyboard shortcut on Windows, Control Shift plus D, on Mac, Command plus Shift plus D. And you can actually set this up so you don't have to always hit document. You go into RStudio options, whenever you hit build, it will do the documentation build as well. But I think there's a setting that you can check in RStudio. So after you do the documentation, it will get everything kind of set up for you, and then you just build the package and reload it, and then you can check to see if that worked by just running ?periodic_table, and it should load up the help file that says ?periodic_table in the PE capital R ILDIC package, and boom, then you have it all set up and ready to go. So that package is installed on your machine, and you can do whatever you want with it after that. Put it to GitHub, do whatever you like. Okay, so I think those steps, I was trying to figure out a way to make these number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, but I ran out. So I ran out of time, so I couldn't figure out how to do this. So there's part 1, the 6 steps of part 1, the 2 steps of part 2, and the 4 steps of part 3, reminding you that this is documentation. Okay? Okay. So that's it. Thank you all for your time. I'm happy to stick around and answer questions, and then we'll go drink beer.
Functions. Okay, so that's the first step. So writing functions, and then I don't think it's ever too early because you can always document. The package has a nice infrastructure for documenting your code, and you can do that yourself outside of a package. But like, it's just so much nicer within a package. So.
Mm-hmm. If you ever see yourself reusing it even once more in those days,
yeah.
The candidate.
Yeah.
So this is potentially a good example. Carl Broman has all of these functions that he tends to use over and over and over again, and so he just has a Broman package. So he just immediately can use the library Broman and whatever his analysis is just immediately available. I'm not good about this, so I I don't have a package of functions I use over and over again. I'm trying to work on this to make sure I'm not constantly repeating myself over and over again. I guess I do a lot of stuff with introductory students, and so it's a lot of GT plot code, it's a lot of deep layer code, but yeah, I definitely get better at browsing. If there are functions I'm doing over and over and over again, I should just put it into a package, but yeah, I have not done that.
Yeah. So I have a question. Would it be absurd to extend this to something like real-time data acquisition? So you were talking about established data sets and modify them for public use.
Right.
But have you guys talked at all about sort of acquiring data and while you're acquiring the data, packaging it up for consumption?
Okay, so have you thought about pulling in real-time data instead of data that's a little bit more static and maybe potentially available every now and then?
Yeah, so the example I think I shared with some of the members of this group was, you know, analyzing the bus arrival times for TriMet bus and trains. And that's something that people would potentially be interested in, but they would want it for their own stops.
Mm-hmm.
And so obviously there's so many stops out there that it wouldn't make sense to just publish it in one particular set. And that's just sort of thinking outside.
Yeah, I guess the hard thing is that on CRAN it has to be standard, right? Or so potentially you can have an API.
Yes.
And so that interface is directly with whatever database is constantly updating, and you can have functions that access that thing that's constantly updating. I have never done that sort of thing, but that definitely makes sense too, right? I mean, that's like an extension of what we're talking about here. You want current data sets that are interesting. Well, here's a way to do a data set that happened 10 seconds ago. Right? That sounds super interesting. That should be fun to play with, but I don't have experience working with kind of real-time pulling from a database or using an API that's really important.
Yes. So kind of your goal is to make these data, interesting data sets available to lots of groups now that are trying to have big data repositories like DataTop World.
Right.
But then you don't get kind of the R benefits, I think, of you don't get like the factors and stuff probably, because I think they're just CSVs that don't really do much with it. But you could have these big data sets that way to get the right kind of data.
For sure, yeah, and there is an API. It's on like my reminders of something I need to look at. There is an API for accessing data on world data sets too. And so that is an immediate sort of source that probably I should go play with and see. I have not really played with the data sets there, but they are published all the time. I get the emails saying, we now have a data set out on this. And yeah, I think that all of this stuff is out there in some way. It's just like finding the right R package. How do we actually find the good data sets? Like, there's just so much junk. Like, how do we get through all the junk and actually find interesting stuff? That's where it's like, it's hard. That's why I could spend all summer doing that and find like three interesting data sets. So,
well, obviously, because you're creating R packages of data, and you could create your data in one of these other repositories, maybe, which at least for the size of
for sure.
I don't know if there's any other better limitations to having our packages instead of something else.
No, I mean, I want people using ggplot really quickly, and it's actually one line of code. So just load library by 38, and then here's all the data sets you pull, and then data equals, boom, we're done. It's really slick. So we're always trying to figure out, like, what are the right things to talk about with introductory students, and you don't want to, like, I found talking about importing data is not a great thing. Like, talking about that at the end when they're maybe doing projects or like pulling in different data sets. Even some of those 538 packages, 538 package vignettes that my students wrote, they had other external data sets that they wanted to try to bring in as well. There was like one on weather or something like that they pulled in. And so there are some extensions where we say, yeah, join with this and make this. That's why I say help.
JSON data?
Yes, I have seen that. It is hard. Well, if the JSON file is really nice and only has one entry per thing, then it's super slick and boom, really easy. But then, like, why deploy the JSON, right? So, like, those files, there's a tiny JSON package I played with a little bit that will help you kind of turn this nested thing into a data frame.
HTTR.
Oh, HTTR too. Yeah.
Does that?
Yeah.
What was that?
HTTR.
HTTR.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there's a ton of different data formats, right? So it'd be awesome if we had. Well, it's great to have all these things and then be able to clean them all up and then document your code. And then these are great projects for a second level student to say, here's your data, now clean up and get it in the next format. So, like, all of these things build up, they're great for the beginners. And if you find a data set that's even a little bit ugly, that's why I call it raw data. It doesn't necessarily have to all be tidy in a nice format, but like, document some sort of process to get it in a nice clean format for people. And then we can work with that. So you can have like budget and then budget others for tidy. So beginners can just work with tidy data and more advanced users can really kind of clean it up and get nice sort of data sets. Yes?
So just creating this package, the guiding art was really fast. I guess what I'm wondering now is in terms of our packages and publishing, obviously there's the CRAN network and there's GitHub, but I guess what I don't understand is what goes on CRAN versus what goes on GitHub versus where do packages go once you...
Yeah, that's an excellent question. So immediately, this is the process that we follow. We publish to GitHub first. I think this is pretty standard practice. We publish to GitHub first and we have this is something Hattie talks about a lot in his book, too. So when you publish it to GitHub, it is good to have like a developmental sort of code here. So this is saying, we're on currently 0.2.0 on CRAN, but we're working on implementing new features. And so if you download the package from GitHub, you'll get these new things. These new things that have not been implemented on CRAN yet. Okay, so usually, I don't know if this is standard practice everywhere, but like I see on Twitter all the time that somebody has posted a new package that they put together on GitHub. And then they say, hey, I would love some feedback. Does this work? Does this make sense? Is this cool? And then they get a little bit of feedback from everybody else. And then they go through the process. It's not terrible, but they go through the process of doing all the checks and doing all that kind of stuff and end up with it. What's that?
Your license.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Talk about your license.
Yeah, make sure you give your license.
Right.
It's really important.
That might be the link. I think we need to update our license, actually.
It's not.
We follow the same. So it's whatever the license is on their data. So that's usually the standard practice. And so then as you work on updating the package, you have what is on CRAN, and then you have a working version where you're fixing bugs and developing new things. And every now and then, once every few months, you say, okay, CRAN, I'm gonna send you the update to our package. It goes through the same sort of tests. And instead we get an email saying, hey, it has been published, and there's a link to it. So that's pretty standard practice now, I think. GitHub for a while, then go to CRAN, keep developing on GitHub.
Makes sense.
Yeah. And I highly recommend checking out like have these repos are just awesome to see like how he deals with issues, what his documentation looks like, what his license looks like. They're just excellent. Obviously. But yeah, I encourage you to check out those repositories. And they're on GitHub too. So there's lots of extra like, features you can see the new like cool things that he's working on. He's really good about that, updating the news about things that happen in the community. So they're not necessarily working on the CRAN version. We'll check there and see if we can download the developer version.
Yeah.
Any other questions? That's awesome that you got it to work. It's good.
Yeah, I mean, it's only 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you all so much.